Good morning, church. Welcome to Sunday service. Woo! We're going to have an amazing time this morning, and we want you to join in and worship with us as we sing My Testimony.
Yes.
I know. I liked this so much last week. We're going to sing it again this week.
Right.
Yeah. People know what God has done for us. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. I love that song. If I'm not dead, then He has something in store for me. So don't give up on God. Let Him do a work in you.
Amen.
And let Him see how His love changes your life. Yeah. Worship with us as we sing, Love Changes Everything, because love does change everything.
I see His body breaking
I see his fingers bleed. I see the darkness tremble at the ground below his feet. In the darkest hours, there on Calvary, he was sweetly broken, broken beautifully, broken beautifully. So come out to the waters, come let the broken sing. Come all you sons and daughters, his love changes everything. Come when the fear is fighting, finding the risen King. Come on, let the light, your love changes everything.
Everything, yeah. Oh,
changes everything.
Amen.
So if you don't know Jesus today, I encourage you to know him, because his love is like no other love, and his love changes everything. I want to pray for you right now. Pray for whatever need it is that you have in your life. Write in the comment section, and we will pray. And I know God's going to hear our prayers. And not only that, I know he's going to answer our prayers, because he's answered so many for us. So I just believe he's going to continue to do it, because that's what his word says. Father, I just thank you for your amazing grace today. I thank you, Lord, for the strength that you give us. I thank you, Lord, for giving us that wisdom. When we need it, you said, call upon you for that wisdom to give unto us. And so I thank you today for giving us the wisdom we need. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for directing our paths, helping us, Lord, to seek after you, to know which direction that you want us to go in. And Lord, right now, I just thank you for your healing flowing over those that are sick in body today. Lord, I just thank you for rising them up, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, for that strength that you're giving those that are weak in body. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you have done for us. And Lord, today I just thank you for Pastor Tim. I just ask your anointing to flow through him as he delivers your word. Open our ears and open our hearts to receive what you have for us. I give you all the glory, Lord. I give you all the honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. You know, there is no one like Jesus. No one. The word says that he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And so today we're going to sing a new song that says, what a friend I have in Jesus. And I want you to listen to the words as Shalito sings these verses today and just be encouraged by them, that we have such a great friend in Jesus.
Amen.
Sing it, Shalito.
Thank you, Lord.
I've never heard you say, what have you done for me lately? What have you done to earn my grace? And I've never heard you speak anything but your love for me, anything but identity. What a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you. When no one else could keep their promise, I can always count on you. You've only made me feel that I was welcome in your house, that I was honored and adored. You've seen me at my worst, but you've never held it against me. You're running to me when I return. Thank you, Lord. Oh, what a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you. When no one else could keep their promise, I could always count on. Been my defender
on the battlefield. You've been my father, you've been my rock, you've been my portion, and you're more than enough. You've been my shelter, you've been my strength, you've been my provider again and again. You've been my redeemer, and I can't comprehend how the God of creation would call me his friend. What a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you. No one else could keep their promise. I could always count on you. You've been my Savior, you've been my shield, you've been my defender on the battlefield. You've been my Father, you've been my rock, you've been my portion, and you're more than enough. You've been my shelter, you've been my strength, you've been my provider again and again. You've been my redeemer, and I can't comprehend how the God of creation would call me his friend. What a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you.
No one like you, Lord.
No one else could keep that promise. I can always count on you.
Yes, I can.
What a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you. No one else could keep their promise. I can always count on you.
Sing it one more time. What a friend I found in Jesus.
What a friend I found in Jesus. What a friend I found in you. No one else could keep their promise. I can always count on you.
Oh, yes, I can. Yes, I can. Thank you, Jesus. Aren't you thankful for that today? Come on, let's worship him. Let's worship our friend, Jesus.
Amen. Amen. We can depend on him. We can count on him. And you can rely on him. Every promise that he has given, he's kept. Every word is true. What a friend we have in Jesus. Come on, let's thank the Lord today. Thank you, Lord, for who you are to us, for all that you mean to us, for all that you do for us. What a blessing it is. Well, thank you for joining us once again right back here at the Studio Sanctuary here at Restore Church. And we're just so glad to be lifting up the name of Jesus. And we're so glad to be connecting with each and every one of you. And we're just thankful that you're a part of the broadcast here today. We appreciate each and every one of you. Lifestyle, what a wonderful job. Didn't they do a great job lifting up the name of the Lord? Thank you, Lifestyle, for lifting us up into the presence of the Lord, reminding us how great of a friend that we do have in Jesus and the testimony that we have because of him in our lives. That's what we're thankful for today. So last week we started talking about our testimony, and the subject is brought out and brought in. And that's what we're continuing on today, because this is really the second part of that series, a continuation of what we began last week. And so we're going to be using the same text and the same illustration, the same examples from the Word of God that we began with last week. But oftentimes we recognize what the Lord has done, and that's past tense, what the Lord has done, instead of recognizing present tense, what the Lord is doing in our lives, or future tense, what the Lord wants to do. Oftentimes it's either past tense or future tense, but oftentimes we aren't living in the present as we should, and recognizing that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we should be living today in this day, and recognizing that God has something for us today, right here and right now. Come on, give me a shout out, somebody. Say today. I'm talking about today, what the Lord is speaking to me today, what the Lord wants to do in your life today, what the Lord wants to do in your family today. And that's what we're talking about right here and right now. Now, if you have your Bibles, you can open them with me. Same passage as last week, the same text as last week. We're again right back in Deuteronomy chapter number 6. And we are following the children of Israel as they've been wandering in the wilderness, and as they're getting ready now to cross over Jordan and into their promised land. And that's where we're going to pick up our reading. Now, it's interesting to note that it was the next generation that went into the promised land. It was the second generation that went in and inhabited what God had promised. Because the original generation to which the promise was given, they were complainers. They were grumblers. They griped about it. They were unthankful. They were ungrateful. And as a result, you know, and what they said was this. They said, God, why did you bring us out here to out of Egypt so that we could just die out here in the desert, so that we could die in the wilderness? And he got so tired of their grumbling and complaining that they prophesied to their own end. Their words were self-fulfilling. They did end up dying in the wilderness without ever entering in to their land of promise. The whole generation, with the exception of Joshua and Caleb, just two out of the previous generation, made it into the promised land. But the rest was all the younger generation that made it in. And so in this in the context of this text that I'm getting ready to share with you, I want you to understand that what Moses is doing is he's now talking. This is Moses is coming to the end of the line too. He's not even going to be entering into the promised land. And so he's coming to the end of the line, and he is now talking to the congregation which is now the next generation. And he's reminding them of who they are. And he's reminding them of what God has done. And he is letting them in on all of these things. And so that's where we'll pick up our reading. Let's take a look in verse number 20. So Moses said, in the future, when your son asks you, what is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws the Lord our God has commanded you? Tell him, we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt. I love how this is in the past tense, however. We were slaves. You know, what we once were. Paul said, we were this, we were that. We were, you know, liars. We were cheaters. We were ungodly. But we've been washed. Now we've been saved. And we've been sanctified. But such were some of you, right? And so he said, tell them we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out. That was what we talked about last week, that the Lord brought us out. He brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Before our eyes, the Lord sent signs and wonders, great and terrible, on Egypt and Pharaoh and his whole household. But he brought us out. And this is the key verse, verse number 23. I want you to highlight this verse or underscore this verse, denote it some way that this is the key verse for you today, for me today, for every Christian today. This is still a key verse. But he brought us out from there to bring us in. Notice that. He brought us out to bring us in. That's what it's all about. He didn't just bring us out for the sake of bringing us out. He didn't just bring us out for the sake of deliverance. Sometimes we get that in our mindset and we get that in our attitude that we think, oh, God, just, you know, I'm delivered and that's all and everything's cool and everything's good. But that wasn't all there was and that wasn't all there is. It wasn't just that God delivered them and that they were once slaves and now they have this moniker that we were once slaves, but now what is next? And I think oftentimes we get hung up here and we get stopped here. Instead of moving on to the next, we are satisfied with being brought out instead of being brought in to all that God has prepared for us and the future that God has designed for us. So notice, he said he brought us out from there to bring us in, watch this, and to give us the land he promised on oath to our ancestors. The Lord commanded us to obey all these decrees and fear the Lord our God so that we might always prosper and be kept alive as is the case today. And I'm going to stop right there. I mean, the Lord wants us to fear him, to revere him, and to honor him, and to follow him. Why? So that we may continue to prosper, and that we may continue to live life, a full life, an abundant life. And that is the case today, just as it's always been, Moses is saying. Now, so that's what I want to talk to you. I want to bring the correlation between what they experienced back then in the ancient historical days and what we're experiencing now in the modern era as the children of God. Because just as they were the children of God back then, we are the children of God right now today. Just as they were the seed of Abraham, the Bible says that we are the seed of Abraham by faith. And so we have those same promises and we have the same ideology and we need to do the same that God wanted them to do. We need to be who he has called us to be. And so he wants us to live an abundant life, a victorious life. He wants our lives to prosper. He doesn't want us just to be brought out, but he wants to bring us on in to all that he has for us. Come on, somebody. Can I get a witness out there? Go ahead. Don't be afraid to say amen. Don't be afraid to shout it out today. You see, the main idea is this, that though the Israelites faced many challenges, and again, we're using them because they're there for an example for our lives today. And they faced obstacles, and they faced challenges, and they faced enemies, and they faced difficulties. Oh, does that sound familiar, somebody? I mean, we face all of those things, don't we? We face those same challenges. We face enemies. We face struggles. We face opposition. We face all the things just like they do. We have crises just like they had crises. But God saw them through each and every one. And God will see you through each and every one if you keep your faith and trust in him. Now, don't get caught up like that first generation did and start grumbling and complaining about this, that, and the other. Instead, keep a thankful heart, keep a good attitude, and keep believing and keep trusting in the Lord and keep calling out to him and keep following after him and let him lead you and guide you, because he doesn't just want to bring you out. He wants to bring you in. Yeah. Come on. There's something better. There's something more. God brought him out to bring him in, and he'll do the same for each and every one of us today. So for the children of Israel, it was a two-step process. Their deliverance was one of bringing them out and then bringing them in. But notice that wasn't successive in a time frame as it should have been. It was only 11-day journey from Egypt to Canaan. However, it took them 40 years. Why? Because of their attitude. Not because of God's, but because of their attitude, because of their unbelief, because of their disobedience. They ended up wandering in the wilderness. In fact, the whole generation died in the wilderness, as I mentioned. And so it was a two-step process. But that second part is what we're focusing on today. Why? Because in the life of a believer, there are ordinarily two steps, quite separate from each other. The bringing one out of sin, bringing one out of the world, which is what the Lord does. He delivers us. He brings us out. He saves us. Come on, somebody. And that's where our testimony begins, right? But then the second part is bringing us into a state of complete rest afterward. Now, Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter number 6 and verse number 23, we read it just a moment ago, that he brought us out from there to bring us in and give us what he promised. And that's what I'm talking about. God wants to give us what he promised. Too oftentimes, we get brought out and then we stop right there instead of getting brought in to what God promised. And God wants us to be brought in to what he promised. Not just brought out of the bad stuff, but brought into the good stuff. I don't want to just stay away from the bad stuff. I want to get into the good stuff. And that's what God has purposed for each and every one of his children. Just like he did back then, he still does today with you and I. If we are Christ followers, he wants the best for us. He wants us to be blessed. He wants us not just to leave our mess. He wants us to enter in to his best. Come on now. That's what I'm talking about. Now, the Bible clearly shows that our salvation was planned to bring us out of the world and bring us into the promises of God. Now, if you like, to deliver us from hell and destine us for heaven. But notice Jesus didn't necessarily say that was why he came. In fact, in John 10:10 that we like to quote around here at Restore Church, Jesus said this, and I'm going to use the Amplified version, and this is what Jesus said. He said, "I am come that they may have life and that they might have it in abundance to the full, till it overflows." That's what God has. That's what God designed. That's what God desires for each and every one of us. And if we're not experiencing that, it means we've stopped somewhere in the wilderness. We've come out of where we were supposed to come out of. We've come out of sin. We've come out of the world, but we've not yet entered into all that the Lord has for us. Uh-oh. Come on now. Come on now, somebody. That's what I'm talking about. Now, Jesus came to give us what? Life. But not just eternal life, not just everlasting life, not just life in heaven, but watch this. He came to give us the heavenly quality of life. That is abundant life, full life, overflowing life right here and right now. You say, well, all this is happening and the circumstances and situation. And well, let's go back again and look at the children of Israel that were in the wilderness and going through the bitterness and going through the trouble and going through the challenges and difficulties. And there were enemies that had surrounded them on every side. And yet they were entering in to their land of promise. They were entering in to what God had promised them to have. They wanted the best that he had, and he wanted the best that he was giving them. Hey, it's no different with us today. We can get focused on all the wrong things. We can get focused on all the enemies, on all the trouble, on all the challenges, on all the difficulties, or we can keep our focus on the Lord. We can keep our attention on him and recognize recognize that eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, all the things that God has prepared for those that love him. I want to get that. I don't want to just leave the mess. I've done that, but I want to get to the best. That's what God has for me. And I want to do that. Come on now. So is that the kind of life you're experiencing today as a Christian? Are you experiencing a full Christian life, an overflowing, abundant life? Because if you're not, you need to do a double check. And I'm not talking about State Farm. I'm talking about you need to do a double check on where you are and what's going on in your mind, in your attitude, in your heart. Oh, come on, somebody. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. I can see you out there in the internet, and you need to recognize, hey, God's word is true. Sadly, today, many Christians don't know anything about the abundant life that Christ came to bring us and wants us to be brought into. Glory. Come on now. And as a result, they're not quite where they should be, could be, or ought to be in God. Amen. Just keeping it real today. Come on, somebody. That's what I'm talking. I'm just keeping it real. Don't get mad at me. I'm just bringing the mail today. That's all I'm doing. But I don't know about you, but for me and my house, I want to be brought in, not just brought out. I've been brought out of darkness, but it's one thing to be brought out of darkness. It's another thing to be brought into his marvelous light, Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse number 9. I want to be brought into the marvelous, not just out of the mundane. Come on. I want to be brought into all the blessings and the goodness that God has for each and every one of us. I may have come out. I need to come in. You follow what I'm saying? Yeah. Now, bringing us in to all that God promises us, watch this, is the work of the Holy Spirit. Here's the rub. It's the Holy Spirit working in, working on, working through us to get us where we need to be. The impact of the Holy Spirit in the human spirit, impacting the mind, the mentality, the ambitions, the dreams, the visions of God's children. That's why we need so desperately the Holy Spirit in our lives. We need the Holy Spirit right here and right now. We need to be not just, we need to be led of the Spirit. As many as are led of the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God, the scripture said. You know, I don't want to just be led out of bondage. I want to be led into glory. I don't want to be just led out of Egypt and led out of sin. I want to be led into the victory of God and victorious living that he has for me. If I'm not living abundant life, if I'm not living victorious, then somewhere, somehow, I've stopped along the way, or I've stopped along the path, or I'm not doing exactly what I need to be doing. That's why I need the Holy Spirit. Why? Because when I don't know what to do, when I don't know what to say, when I don't know what to pray, the Holy Spirit makes intercession and teaches me what I need to pray, teaches me what I need to do. Come on, somebody. That's what I'm talking about. And that's why we need the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Now, the Holy Spirit will do what? Will bring us into a life of peace. There's not a lot of peace in this world that we live in right now. Not a lot of peace in this society that we live in right now. Right? I mean, we read the news. We understand what's going on around us. But guess what? The people of God, the people that are called by his name, the people that are filled with his Spirit are going to be brought into a place of peace. Isaiah prophetically proclaimed, Isaiah 26 and verse number 3, he said, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you." Watch this. All those whose thoughts are fixed on you. And I just wonder today, how many have their thoughts fixed? Or how many have their thoughts broken today? Maybe our thinking is broken today and it needs to be fixed. Maybe. I know I'm doing a little play on words here. I hope you're following along. And, don't freak out on me here. But I understand this. It's all about having our hearts fixed. Now, I understand what that means. That means focused, like laser focused on the Lord and laser focused on Him, that we aren't looking to the right hand or the left hand, but we're looking straight ahead and we're following Him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength into the future that He has for us. He's brought us out already. We have a testimony. Come on, we all have a testimony. We talked about that last week. He brought us out of darkness, but guess what? He's bringing us into, right? The marvelous light. Bringing us into the blessings, the future that He has for us. And so I need my thoughts fixed. But I think too many people don't have their thoughts fixed on Christ because their thoughts are broken. Their thoughts aren't focused on Jesus because all they can focus on is all the other stuff, all the peripheral stuff, the peripheral things that are going on. It's one thing to know what's going on, and it's another thing to let that infect you and affect you and affect your motion and your momentum. Because if we're not careful, we can allow these things to stop us from moving in God's direction and where He wants us to go and where He's bringing us. I don't want to be affected adversely. I don't want to be moved. I want to go with the Lord and follow His direction each and every time. Come on, somebody. Yeah. Now, notice what Jesus said. Jesus was talking about the Holy Spirit that was going to be sent, the Comforter that was going to come. And the very next verse in John chapter 14, and verse number 27, this is what Jesus says. He says, "Peace is what I leave with you. It's my own peace that I give you. I do not give as the world does. Do not be worried and upset. Do not be afraid." Now, Jesus is about the work of the Holy Spirit, and then He's talking about His peace. And as a result, He's saying, don't be worried, don't be upset, don't be afraid. Now, here's a good little litmus for you and where you are as a Christian. Are you worried? Are you upset? Are you afraid? Because if you are, then that means your focus is not perhaps where it needs to be. In fact, I can take the perhaps out and say, I know it's not where it's supposed to be because you're not focusing on the Lord high and lifted up. If your focus is on the Lord, you recognize that all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are called according to His purpose. And you know what? There's no reason to worry. There's no reason to stress. There's no reason to fret about this situation, about that situation, about politics, about, the culture and the cancel culture and all of the stuff that's going on and all of the adverse things that are happening in our world. But if you're worried, and if you're afraid, and if you're upset, watch this, somebody, pay close attention. That's not the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not. Sorry to break your bubble, bust your bubble, whatever. But it's not the work of the Holy Spirit. If you're walking in fear, then you're not walking in the Spirit. Come on, somebody. We're supposed to be walking with peace. We're supposed to be brought into peace and living a life of peace. That's what the Lord is bringing us into. We've been brought out of bondage. We've been brought out of sin. We've been brought out of darkness, but we are brought into now peace. Secondly, He wants to bring us into a life of joy, a life of peace and a life of joy. And these are bookends to the Christian life. They both go together, peace and joy. In fact, that's what the kingdom of God is all about, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Again, it's the work of the Holy Spirit. And so if we're not following the Holy Spirit, if we're not being led of the Holy Spirit, then that's where we're going to have challenges and issues in these areas. Now, in Proverbs chapter 10 and verse number 20, 8, it says this, the prospect of the righteous is joy, but the hopes of the wicked come to nothing. Well, what does that mean? That means if you're a true believer, the expectation that you should have should be an expectation of joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength. You should be expecting God in His fullness. You should be expecting peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. You should be expecting, anticipating that God is going to bring and God is going to lead and God is going to direct you into a life of joy. Does that mean you're happy all the time? No, that isn't what I'm talking about. Joy isn't that everything's happy, slappy all the time and everything is, you know, giddy all the time. No, I'm talking about joy, a deep down sense of joy in your soul, knowing that the Lord is your God and that you can trust in Him. And no matter what the situation and no matter what the extraneous circumstances, He's got you in His hands. Come on. That's the testimony that you have. It's part of your testimony. You've been brought out to be brought in. Brought into a life of joy. Now, the Holy Spirit brings you joy. Did you know that? Romans chapter 15 and verse number 13. May the God of hope, Paul wrote, fill you with what? All joy and peace. There you go. There's the bookends. They're together. Hard to separate them. Joy and peace. With all joy and peace in believing through the experience of your faith, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will abound in hope. Now, what is hope? It's divine expectation. It's expecting God to do what God said He would do, to God to be who He said He would be, for God to accomplish His word in your life. It's just an expectation. That's what the power of the Holy Spirit at work in you and work in me provides. And so we shouldn't be, you know, we shouldn't be doom and gloom. We shouldn't be filled with dread and fear. Those things are not works of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, come on now. We're talking about what the kingdom of God operates by. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And that's what should be at work in our lives, bringing us into the blessing of God, bringing us into the goodness of God, bringing us into the mercies of God, the grace of God, the unmerited favor of God, all of the good things that God has in store. God is interested in us receiving. Glory to God. Every good and perfect gift comes down from above, doesn't it? Amen. You know, God doesn't withhold any good thing from those that walk uprightly. I'm just telling you what the word says today. But that we may abound in hope and overflow with the confidence of His promises. Confident that what He said, He will do. What He promises, He will perform. You see, folks, I'm not satisfied with just being brought out of my past. Yes, I do have a past. I have a BC life, a life that, you know, things that I did before I really committed my life to Christ, before He really became Lord of my life. And the life that I now live is by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. But you know what? I'm not just satisfied with saying, yeah, I came out of that. I'm not just content with that. I mean, that's a great testimony, and everybody needs to have a great testimony. Come on now. You need to have a great testimony that God has brought you out of this, that, or the other. But what is God bringing you into? That's the second part of your testimony. What is God doing in my life right now? That's the second part of my testimony. What does God want to accomplish in me? What future? What promise? What purpose does God have for me to fulfill right now and in the near future? You see, that's the second part. He brought us out, bring us in. He has something better for us. As I mentioned earlier, eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, hasn't even entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared. For who? For those that love Him. for those that trust him, for those that are following him. And that's who I want to be. That's what I want to do. So in conclusion to this message today, hey, folks, as I said, the kingdom of God, kingdom living, is about what? It's about righteousness. It's about doing the right thing. It's about living right. Come on, that's where it starts. And then it's about peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. But notice, those are byproducts of the Holy Spirit at work in my life. Those are byproducts of the Holy Spirit at work in your life. And if those byproducts aren't there, then that means the Holy Spirit is not at work in your life. And if that's not the case, then there's an issue. And you need to say, man, I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. Right here and right now. Lord, fill me up to overflowing with the Holy Spirit, because I want to live a life of righteousness. I want to live a life of peace. I want to live a life of joy that you are interested in bringing me into, so that I can not just experience the testimony of where I've come from, but the testimony of where you've brought me to and where you're bringing me to. That's what it's all about today, folks. Come on. God wants to bring us into the fullness of his promises. God wants to bring us into the fullness of his purposes. God wants to bring us into the fullness that he has for each and every one of us. The abundant life. That's what it is, the John 10:10 life. It's heavenly life right now. Heavenly living right here. Today, in spite of the circumstances, in spite of pandemics, in spite of trouble, in spite of angst, in spite of stress, in spite of uncertainty, you can live that life right now through Jesus Christ. Say, how can I do that? It's a work of the Holy Spirit. It's a divine work. It's the only way. Bringing you into abundant life, overflowing life, life that is refreshing, that is renewing, that is restoring every single day. That's not something we can do on our own. That is only done by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's why you need to pray and say, Holy Spirit, I need that in my life. I need that to lead and guide and direct me right here and right now today. And if that's you, I want to pray for you. And if you're feeling you need that, I want to pray for you. Life is more than being stressed and oppressed and fleshed, but it's about being blessed. And it's about God's best. And that's what's available right here and right now. Is that what you want? That's what I want. And I want that for you. God wants that for you. But if you want that for you, that's the million-dollar question. And if the answer is yes, pray with me right now. And let's go to the Lord together and elicit his help. That's the only place we can go, is to the Lord. Lord, we're looking to you right now. We're calling out to you right now. We recognize we need your help. We need your strength. We need your wisdom. We need, Lord, your righteousness, peace, and joy in our lives. We need not just to be brought out. Maybe we need to be brought out today. But beyond that, we need to be brought into the best that you have, the goodness that you have, the promises and purposes that you have for each and every one of us. Lord, the life abundantly, the life of joy, the life of peace, the life of promise, all of these things that are available through you by the work of your Holy Spirit. Let it come in to us right now. Lord, cleanse us right now. Wash us right now. Forgive us of our sins right now. Lord, we open ourselves to you. Come into this vessel. Fill us with your Holy Spirit right now. We cannot just be brought out of where we need to be brought out of bondage, brought out of sin, brought out of, but Lord, so that we may be brought into the blessing, brought into the promises, brought into the purposes of God for our lives, for our future, in Jesus' name. Let it begin in each and every one that prayed this prayer with me right now today, in Jesus' name. amen. Somebody give me a big amen if you agree with that prayer. Amen, somebody? Amen. Amen. He brought us out to bring us in. I don't know about you. I don't want to get stuck somewhere along the way. I want to get to where he wants me to be. And I want you to get to where he's bringing you to also. Don't let anything hang up your progress. You keep moving forward in faith into the future that God has purposed for you. In Jesus' name. Well, God bless you. That's what I have for you today. God bless seeing you. Good to have you. Good to be with you on this wonderful Lord's Day. My prayer is that we're going to get together here live very soon. You keep praying for that. God's working some things together and on us getting a place of worship and it getting put together. And all we're going to keep bringing you the news and the reports and the visuals until that happens. But pray with me that that would be expedited. And what a blessing that would be. I'd love to see you guys face to face. I love seeing you online, but it would be much sweeter to see you face to face. Until then, I'll see you online, on YouTube, and on Facebook, as usual. God bless you.